Looking for a new car or truck? TheAutoChannel.com has the most complete and up-to-date pricing, vehicle specifications, and reviews.
Thank you for your very informative presentation. I have two comments here. One, in answer to one of your questions, you said 43 miles per gallon was not sustainable, yet the first half of your presentation paraded a bunch of non-hydrogen vehicles that claimed gas mileages and way in excess of that, and that's just an inconsistency in your message.
That's right.
Where's the hydrogen going to come from in the U.S.
Well, that's a good question.
In order to power the hydrogen cars?
That's a good question. And first of all, there is no inconsistency between saying that we can make 35 miles per gallon technologically and saying it is not an economically feasible solution, because the technological content that we would have to put into every vehicle to get a 35 mile per gallon fleet is going to be somewhere between $6,000 and $10,000 per vehicle, and that on cost, we can't eat it. It's going to have to be passed on to the public. Technologically, we know how to do it. There's no question about it. I mean, we can demonstrate a 40 mile per gallon fleet if we're absolutely called upon to do it. The problem is the public is not going to want to pay the price. That's the problem. Hydrogen. It's an oft-asked question, where is the hydrogen going to come from, because hydrogen doesn't exist in a free state. But hydrogen is available in a lot of forms. For instance, oil refineries are constantly flaring off hydrogen and not putting it to any good use. And it is basically a byproduct of petroleum production. Some companies are now already offering so-called natural gas reformers, which would be a device about the size of a small refrigerator that you put in your garage. And this thing takes natural gas and converts it to hydrogen, so that you could basically, if you had one of these reformers in your garage, you could park your hydrogen-powered vehicle in the garage and fuel it overnight off of the reformer. A lot of work is being done now on biomass hydrogen generation, where you basically use bacteria in swamps and put huge plastic bags over the swamp and trap the hydrogen so that it would be basically biomass hydrogen. I'm convinced that if we do decide on the other way, of course, is catalysis of water, but that requires electrical input, and that's where you can create all the hydrogen that you ever need as long as you've got sufficient electrical power. I'm convinced that as we move to a hydrogen economy, we will get the hydrogen. Now, you raise a very good, kind of little bit unasked question. What's it going to cost to create the hydrogen? Where does the energy come from? And then what energy do you use to compress the hydrogen in its, say, atmospheric state to get it into those cylinders where it's compressed to 10,000 psi. And compressing a gas to 10,000 psi is obviously going to require more energy. And if that energy comes from petroleum sources, then I would say, you know, we haven't achieved a hell of a lot. If it comes from electricity that's generated from non-petroleum, then we have achieved at least the goal of shifting from a petroleum-based economy to some other energy source. And in my judgment, as we displace petroleum and go to alternate forms of energy, say electricity or hydrogen, we are not going to be able to continue to be one of the only countries in the world that says we don't want nuclear power. Because at some point, there's only so many windmills and only so many solar mirrors, they're not going to do it. I would ask you to, when we talk about windmills, this is my last thought for the day. Let us say, and the scientists, especially environmental scientists, love to talk about windmills. we extract energy. I'm not a scientist. My degrees are in marketing, which is I'm ashamed to admit. But one thing I did learn in physics is that there is no such thing as spontaneously created energy. Energy is always shifted from one state to another. It's always an energy trade-off. And when you get energy, it means that something else is giving up energy. But there's no new energy being created except what streams in from the sun every day. So assuming that we were to put up windmills everywhere, I mean enormous banks of windmills, and get a substantial amount of our electrical energy from windmills, where does the free lunch come from? If energy is not created but is only traded, where does all this electrical energy come from when windmills? I will tell you where. It is energy that is extracted from the moving air mass. And if you take enough energy out of the moving air mass, that also is going to have some climatological consequence somewhere. If you suck enough energy out of the moving air, you are disrupting the natural airflow patterns on the planet, and you're going to have some sort of climatological effect. I put that to some of our in-house scientists, and they said, I don't think anybody's ever looked at that. So I let you guys ponder that one for a while. But it's in the category of when it comes to energy, there is no free lunch. Thank you.
Thanks for watching the Auto Channel. For more Press Pass coverage, visit theautochannel.com, the Internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive information resource.